and make it whole again. Well, here's the pieces of my heart. What can you do with them? 'Cause I can't hold them all together anymore. So I let them fall surrendered to the floor. You make all things new. You make all things new. God of mercy and love, do what only you can do, and make all things new. Only you can bring such beauty from the depths of all my pain. Only you can take this shattered heart and make it beat again. Oh, you hold us all together in your hands. I surrender all I have and all I am. You make all things new. And make all things new. From the ashes, from the dust, I will rise up. I'll rise up out of darkness into light. I will rise up, oh, rise up.
Wow, what a declaration for today, that he would make all things new. Thank you, Pastor Kelly. And Rick, what an incredible, incredible message to that song. I pray that you in your heart are experiencing or desiring, anticipating all things to become new. And as we dive in today, and Pastor Brian mentioned about our Acts journals, and yes, those are available there, and we're almost out. There's only a handful left from all we purchased, and I can't believe they're almost all gone. And I know some who are watching online, I want you to know that we're getting another shipment in on Tuesday of this week. If you'd like to swing by, if you watch online and you want to walk with us, I'd love for you to have a copy of this as well. You can stop by the church anytime throughout the week and pick one up. Make sure that you get your copy if you don't have one yet, and make sure that you bring that, if you're able, with you on Sundays. As we start this new year, we anticipate the Lord doing some really incredible things. We're asking, as we walk through this journey, as we launch today into the book of Acts, and we launch into this study on all the incredible things that Jesus Christ, when he left and he sent the Holy Spirit to empower us, that we, the church, would rise and be all that God has called us to be. I pray that this journey is an incredible journey for you. And we really want it to be a powerful season in our lives. I want it to be an incredible moment in our lives every single week as we study God's word and dive in. And I think there's a power in journaling. And so as you take your scripture journal and you write maybe some of the things that are in the message, but maybe some things that the Lord is speaking to you, and those will be between you and the Lord. Maybe he'll impress some things that you need to write them down, as the Bible tells us, and you use that as an incredible guide for your journey this year. I don't know about you, but I am excited for 2022. I want 2022 to be a great year, a goodbye 2020, 2021. I anticipate good things. I like what Pastor Brian said. Come on, we get what we expect. How many of you are expecting good things this year? I'm going to expect it. I want it. I'm hungry for it. And in order to enhance that, I just want you to know that in a week, starting on January 10th, we are going to launch into a season of fasting and prayer and fasting, and we're going to ask the Lord to move on our behalf. I'm going to talk a little bit about that later in the message today. I'm going to talk a little about that. You'll see it on throughout the week, and some instruction and some various things. Fasting is when we set aside something in our life because we want or need or desire. We are asking, we are humbling ourselves before the Lord, and we're asking him to move in our lives. Sometimes we fast just so that we can have some spiritual development. Sometimes we want the Lord to remove some things. Maybe we need a breakthrough. Maybe we need some direction in our lives, and we're saying, God, I'm going to set this aside because I need your direction in my life. I need your leadership in my life. Maybe we need to overcome some things in our life. You know, as Jesus overcame temptation through his 40 days of fasting and prayer that were brought to him, maybe we need some victory in our lives. I want to encourage you to consider joining us on this journey. All of the days that we will be fasting for 21 days, we're going to fast and we're going to pray. Maybe you set aside some meals. Maybe you set aside certain things that you have just really loved and enjoyed. And you say, you know what, for this 21 days, I'm going to set those things aside, and I am going to seek the Lord and ask him to move on my behalf, ask him to move on our church's behalf. And online, you're going to be able to see, as we launch it next week, every single day, there will be a specific prayer focus over our church, over our leaders, over our mission, over this valley, asking the Lord to do some incredible things. And so I would just love to invite you this week to prepare your heart, pray about, ask the Lord, Lord, what would you have me do this week? Because I want to get closer to you. I don't know about you, but I'm hungry for the Lord, and I want him to move in our midst and on our behalf and in our lives and in our homes. And so we're going to launch that. We're excited about it. I invite you to take part in that if you are able. We're going to dive into the book of Acts along with fasting and prayer, and I believe that we are going to begin to see God move in our hearts, in our lives, in this church. And so what a journey it's going to be, and it all begins today on the first Sunday of the year. What a great Sunday to partake of communion. What a great Sunday to launch into all things new that the Lord has for us. Goodbye to all the old, hello to all the new. Amen? Amen. Excited about that. I hope that you had a great Christmas. Hope that you had a great new year. I think that when we walk through these times and these moments in our lives, it really does open our hearts to many times the promising hope of better days. There's a promising hope in our lives that better days are ahead. And I think that that's very appropriate for the day and age that we live in, that we would experience today a hope, a promising hope for better days ahead. The gift of hope is very powerful. When you are given a promise by someone, how many of you have ever given or received a promise from someone? And sometimes that promise that is made, man, that is awesome. And maybe you've experienced someone who has made a promise to you and then they didn't fulfill their promise. You felt let down, you felt betrayed, you felt forgotten about, you felt maybe alone or lonely, maybe someone hurt you because the promises they made that they were going to do, maybe it was in business, maybe it's in relationship. I think one of the greatest promises we can make is as a husband and wife, when we make a promise to one another. And when we make that promise and that commitment to one another, there's this excitement, there's this anticipation of this life that we're about to spend together, and the journey of life happens. And yeah, there's some ups and there's some downs, but boy, what an incredible, incredible moment when we live those promises in our lives. I want you to know that today, this sermon, this message, I think we kick off this book of Acts with the title, The Promise. Because right here in the beginning of this book, in the first five verses we're going to look through today, there's an incredible promise that is given to you and to myself. The book of Acts is divided into really three sections. The first seven chapters really talk about the spread of the gospel in Jerusalem. The next five chapters, 8 through 12, really talk about moving into the gospel spreading and really advancing into the kingdom of Judea and Samaria. Also then in the last part of the book, chapter 13 through 28, is really being witnesses to the ends of the earth. God has a plan for his church. He has a plan for your life. He has a calling on you and on us as individuals, as a church. God has a plan, a purpose, and I believe over the next few weeks, we're going to begin to see that unfold in our lives. The book of Acts is really a continuation of the book of Luke. It was written by Luke. Listen to this. Of all the New Testament books, it is the most historically verifiable books. It is filled with names and locations which can be attested to by archaeology, by other scrolls, by other writings, and it all comes together in this incredible manner as one of the most historically accurate books of what takes place. This book, Acts, is a picture of the early church. It's a historical document of what took place in the first century church. Without it, we probably would know very little about the early church. It really is our guide to the beginnings of and what took place in the early church as we were. And as we begin this journey today, I pray that this journey will empower us. I believe that it will enrich our lives, that it will take us to new depths, maybe depths that we've never seen before in our own personal walk and relationship with Jesus. And so Let's take our Bibles, and if you have your scripture journal, you can open that too. If you don't have one, you can open up your Bible there and read along with me. If you don't have either of those, I do have it on the screen for you, but I do encourage you, if you can, every single week, bring your copy of the Word of God, whether it's a digital text, whether it's the written word, have your journal, whatever it is, so that you can follow along. Let's dive in right now to Acts chapter 1, verse 1 and verse 2, and you see there, it talks about, the very heading itself says, the promise of the Holy Spirit. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. The Gospel of Luke points out, if you take a look there, if you have a pen or you can grab one in front of you, that just that, even that first phrase, it says, in the first book, underline that. You see, there was a first book, it was the Gospel of Luke. This is a continuation of that book, and Luke here saying, Theophilus, in my first book, I did these things. I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and to teach. The Gospel of Luke really points to the fulfillment of the scriptures in everything that had taken place in that time through Jesus that had been prophesied hundreds and thousands of years ago. And all of those prophecies began to be unleashed and fulfilled. It's an incredible book of the fulfillment of prophecy. And we saw in Luke, I don't have this verse behind me, but if you want to write it down, it's Luke 24, verse 44 and 45. He says, then he said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scripture. Luke's two books explain that history itself hinged upon the life of Christ and the pouring out of his Spirit. The laws of Moses were given, and at that time, it was one of the most advanced set of laws that the world had ever seen. It began to talk a little bit about cleanliness. It talked about sterilization. It talked about some unique things, sanitary things, sanitation, and it really just began to talk about how to protect yourself from infectious disease. Listen to this. It was at that time the Moses law, that justice took a giant leap forward at that time. But most importantly, through that law, listen to what we learned. We learned this. There was an incredible realization that rebellion against God is serious. And it is so serious at that moment that blood, it was talking so serious about our hearts and our lives, that when we opposed God, when we walked away from him, that in order to atone for those sins, those wrongs, that blood must be shed. They offered sacrifices. They gave sacrifices to atone for those things. Later, as Luke talked about, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, he came to become the ultimate sacrifice for you and I. He became the blood sacrifice. His blood was shed at Calvary so that you and I would have atonement and forgiveness of our sin. But mankind throughout history had great difficulty keeping the laws of the Lord, had difficulty keeping the laws of God. There was this perpetual cycle that began to happen all throughout the generations. And maybe you've witnessed these things even in your own life. Here's what happened. The Lord would bestow his blessing upon his people. He would then bestow prosperity upon them. And then all of a sudden, there was a turning away from him. And then there was judgment, and then there was repentance, and they would come back to the Lord, and then he would bestow his blessing upon them, and then there would be prosperity, and then they would turn away, and then there would be judgment, and then there would be repentance, and this cycle just seemed to continue throughout their history. But in that moment, through these prophecies, there was a glimmer of hope that began to arrive. There was a promise of a future king who would come, that would come in the line of David, a blessing to the whole world that was coming. He would reign over this world in righteousness forever. That was the promise that took place at the end of Luke's book. The prophet predicted that the day would come when the Spirit would be poured out on men and women. Israel had come out of captivity. They had spent years in captivity. Judgment led to repentance, led to blessing, and they were caught in this cycle. And there was a time when they were overtaken by people around them. Other powers occupied their land. Rome at this time occupied the land and imposed taxation while controlling the holy temple grounds, even naming the high priest who would serve. They placed that position. They were under Roman rule. People in that day were looking and awaiting a Messiah, but they were very disappointed in Jesus. How can we say that? How could people be disappointed? I want you to know that their eyes were fixed on a different kind of Savior. They were looking for someone who would give them a way out of their oppression under Rome. They were looking for help. They were a people looking for a better life. They were people looking for a hero, a champion, a savior from Rome. Here's what he offered. He offered salvation for their souls, but they wanted salvation from their Roman oppressors. They were looking for a savior to alleviate their stress, their bondage, all the things that they were walking through. And he was coming to offer them complete eternal salvation. He offered a kingdom that was spiritual and eternal, but they were only focused on the needs that they had that day. I want you to see this. They wanted an earthly kingdom that would conquer the surrounding nations around them. They were hoping for a champion who would come and defeat and beat down in a military fashion, that they would see this take place, and that's what their eyes were fixed on. And then Jesus died. He died. He can't be the Messiah. He died. And then he was raised to life again. We know what an incredible picture and a story at the end of the Gospels as he goes out. Here's the situation that you and I, we have to face, and we each have to ask this question on our own. And if you're here today and you're listening to this and you're watching online, if we could just ask ourselves the question. You see, there's a problem, and many times this is the problem that you and I face today. You and I face this exact same problem. The eternal blessing, the eternal spiritual blessing that are ours to receive in Christ. They are there. They are for us. They are ready. He is willing. He is able. He has all these things ready for you and I. Yet so many times we are hung up on the temporary, physical things that you and I encounter every single day. And those things become the very thing that we are looking for our Savior to save us from. We're looking for his salvation in the pressure in the temple. Oh, God, come on, I've prayed the prayer. Save us from this pandemic. Send it down the river. How many are ready for it to go down the river today? There's nothing wrong with that. We don't want that in our lives. We understand that. Next week, we are going to talk very closely. We're going to take a look at some this next few passages, and we're going to talk, did you know, do you believe all things work together for good for him who loves the Lord? Do you believe that all things means all things? All things means a pandemic. Did you know that out of strife and difficulty, great things can happen? Did you know there was strife? I'm about to start talking about what I want to talk about next week. There's an incredible picture here that we see and we learn and we understand. They wanted an earthly kingdom that would help knock down the surrounding nations. The eternal spiritual blessing is ours to receive, but too many times our eyes are just fixed on the problems that face us today, the issues that face us today. Lord, help us today. And there's nothing wrong with that. However, if that is our focus needs to be on the spiritual blessing that Jesus Christ came to make a way out of the difficulty. Yes, he watches over us. He keeps us. He gives us victory. He washes away all fear. We don't have to live in fear. We can live because he came to give us life, hope. He came to give us a future. We know that our lives are in his hand. While tiny Israel, as important as they were at that time the center of the crossroads of the world. Man, it is where it was all happening. God's kingdom in that moment was about to invade the whole earth. I want you to know this. On the onset of, as we dive into Acts, the book of Acts is the beginning of a worldwide invasion of the presence of Almighty God through the power of the Holy Spirit. It's where the invasion begins. Adam and Eve, you see, they gave up their authority. They gave it up in the garden when they sinned and were disobedient. They rebelled against God. That is why Satan is called the ruler of this world, the ruler of the world. Adam and Eve, they gave up their authority when they rebelled against God. And now in this moment, a man has come to the world, lived a perfect, sinless life, and he took back, through his obedience to his Father, he took back everything. He faced the enemy on the cross and he won. He faced the enemy on the cross and he won. We are victorious in the name of Jesus today. The world is being reclaimed. Listen to this. Not for all men. It is available for all men, but it is being won back for those who put their trust in the victor, Jesus Christ. It is available for every woman, every man, every child. It is available for you and I. However, the salvation that he brought and the power that he brings is for those who say yes to Jesus. This is the basis of the book of Acts. Jesus is taking back that which was lost to the enemy, the souls of men and women who hear his voice and put their trust in him. In this moment, in the beginning of the book of Acts, as he is departed, he is leaving them, and he tells them, he gives them some instruction here shortly we'll get to. But in this moment, Jesus brought a refreshing freedom, love, joy, peace to everyone around him. The chaos of the crowds, the chaos of everything that was happening, in all of that chaos around Jesus, there was a calm. He walked with authority, confidence. Nobody had talked like he talked. No one had said the things that he was saying. He was different. No wonder the crowds were gathering. No wonder that people were flocking to him. No one had ever spoken like this man. Now this fresh breeze that was beginning to blow, that breeze now was about to become a wind that would sweep through the entire world. It was just the beginning. Verse 3 in Acts tells us this. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs. Everyone say proofs. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. Jesus appeared to them. The Bible is very clear about this. It's talked about in other passages. It's talked about in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3 through 8 gives us, this is what takes place. Jesus shows up, of course, to the two men on the Emmaus Road. He also meets them in the room, and he begins to share and talk, and he meets the disciples there. The Bible says that he appeared to Cephas. He appeared to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 people, then to James and the apostles. Lastly, he appeared to Paul. These historical recorded proofs are the witness to Jesus. He appeared to them in many proofs. He came to them and he showed them in a physical appearance, telling the world, Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. Jesus is real. Jesus is alive. I have come back from the dead. I am here among you. He said, here, touch the nail scarred feet on my hand. Why? Look. Yeah, no, they're there. I'm here with you. The Bible says that he ate with them. He wasn't just a spirit body. He was physically returned and restored. He came back. Greek mythology at that time taught some very unique principles. It taught that certain people, men, could die and become a god. Not one of those was a physical resurrection. It was happening in their belief in the spiritual, that they were going to die and in the next life become a god. This was a very incredible teaching that took place. It is not by happenstance. It was a divine order through the teaching of that day that Jesus Christ, this didn't just happen spiritually. He came back. He walked among them. He lived. He ate with them. He taught them after he had been crucified, after he had died. This was the beginning of an incredible movement. The groundswell was beginning to take place. Isaiah predicted that the Messiah would be put in the grave, yet his days would be prolonged, and we would see the fruit of them. The psalmist himself declared that the body of the Holy One would not see decay. The physical resurrection was the assurance that God had accepted the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, his Son, for our sins. He appeared to them. He ate with them. He talked with them. He taught them. This is the key, because it was in this moment that there was about to be unleashed upon that day a movement, the power of the Holy Spirit, and the disciples were about to go out. This is what the disciples were about to proclaim to the world. Jesus Christ is real. Jesus Christ is alive. Jesus Christ is alive. At the time, people said, you're crazy. You're nuts. They did not have Instagram. No, I got proof. I took a picture. They had to go by what was being said. Imagine that. They didn't have social media to declare and post, and it would, I'm telling you, it would have gone viral. Right? That would have been an incredible scene. But they didn't have that. They were listening. They were watching. He appeared to them. He's watching, and in this moment, we see that as this is unfolding, that you and I have a special privilege. You see, Jesus was risen, he was alive, and he was teaching them after his death. When you and I are walking with the Lord close enough, we can hear the whispers of the Spirit. As you read the Word, as you understand it and learn, the Holy Spirit begins to speak to our lives. He opens our minds. He helps us understand what is going on. Listen, church, do not be deceived by the things that are happening in the world. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Open your heart to the power of the Holy Spirit. He will lead you. He will guide you. He will speak to you. He will open up. When you open up the Word, it will become life to you. We can so easily get our eyes fixed on the next day, the next task, the next thing that we have to accomplish. And we need God's blessing to help us in what we are doing. And I believe today that he wants to speak to his church. And he wants us to say, why don't you look? Let's open up our eyes. Let's look to heaven. Let's invite the presence, the power, and the Spirit of the Lord to be ever so real and moving in our hearts and in our lives. I don't know about you, but I want God's Spirit to move in my life. I want God's Spirit to move in this church. I want us to experience the reality of who he is in the fullness of the Spirit that he intended for you and I to walk in. He did not come so that you and I would just make it. He came so that you and I would be empowered, endued with power, that we would experience the fullness of God, that he would lead us and guide us, that he would speak to us, that he would give us visions and dreams, that he would do the things that he talked about. And this is just the beginning. This is where it all begins, and it starts here. And this is what we learn. He opens up our minds to help us understand what he is doing in this day and age. And here is the fulfillment of the promise. Now, you and I, we do not have to wait for him to appear. He is with us wherever we go. He is with us. They were sent to a room, which we're about to read. They were sent to listen. They were sent to wait. You and I, I'm telling you the fulfillment of the promise before I even tell you the promise. The fulfillment of the promise is what you and I get to live in today. But this is where it all began. Let's take a look at verse 4. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. That was the promise. That was the promise of the Holy Spirit. That was the promise that he gave for you and I to walk in, to live in, to understand. This is the promise that he had. Luke 24:49 said this, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Wait, that's from Luke. That's from the book of Luke, chapter 24. Luke foretold of the coming, of the pouring out of the Spirit. He said, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. Joel chapter 2 said, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Lord, help me see visions. I want to stay young. Right? Let us see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. Even on the male and female servants in those days, I will pour out my Spirit. What incredible promises for you and I. What an incredible promise. What's the promise? Even on the dry ground, I will pour out my water. When it's thirsty, I will quench that. Spiritual refreshment for you and I will be like water that hits the dry ground. If you are dry, if you are thirsty, the presence of the Lord is here. There is something that he did at Calvary. And when he rose, he left because he knew we needed the power of the presence of Almighty God through the Holy Spirit. And in order for the Holy Spirit to come, he had to depart. They were like, no, stay with us. Why leave now? Now is the time. He left because he knew what was about to happen. Without his power, without his refreshment, Enduring spiritual battles, walking in victory is impossible. There's a lot of controversy about the baptism of the Spirit. Some call it a second work of grace. Others call it an entire sanctification process that happens. Others refer to it as a full or entire surrender of our lives. Still others believe that it is a one-time event. Others say that it only happens when you are born again. But we see, and we will see later in chapter 2 and chapter 4, that it is repeated with the same men. It is repeated with the same people. Denominations differ on their interpretation of being filled or baptized in the Spirit. Listen to me today. Whatever your conviction, I believe that you and I today, we can agree that we need the refreshing power of God in our lives to be witnesses to this life that we are living. And that was sent to us by the power of the Holy Spirit. Believe that he wants to whisper, he wants to move, let that breeze begin to swell and blow through our lives, that it would become a mighty rushing wind. It's simply a matter of recognizing the need and asking, knowing that God wants to give you that blessing. Without the power of the Spirit, the flesh wins. But with the power of the Spirit, we make a move from selfishness, from our own desires, from our own lives. We move then to something new. We have a renewed mind that causes all of our choices and our plans to be directed and guided by His hand. And that comes when we allow Him to fill our lives full to overflowing. And it's an ongoing process. We see that these believers, they were filled and they needed to be filled again with the Spirit. Conflict stirs in our hearts and in our lives, all throughout our lives. We cry out to God for His help. And in that moment, we're filled again with empowerment. We begin to be led by the Spirit again. You see, the disciples were about to receive this precious gift, this power from on high for the first time. He said, go, wait, don't leave the city, wait for me. There is a gift that I have for you, and it is coming. And the disciples were about to receive the promised gift of the Holy Spirit, a Spirit baptism, so they could go out and live their lives, being an example to those around them of the living Christ Jesus, our Lord. They were about to be commissioned, and Jesus did not want them to go out until they had experienced the power of His Spirit. They were about to be commissioned, and the world would never be the same. Church, as we go through these opening chapters of Acts, I'm going to be challenging you to ask God to give you the promise of the Father, and that is the fullness of the Holy Spirit in your life. Listen, we need Him to be fruitful. We need Him to help renew our minds. We need Him to overcome the battles that we face. We need Him as a church to be witnesses to our family, to this valley, to the world. We need Him. And I'm asking you today, would you open up your heart? Would you ask again? Would you ask the Lord, the Father, to send His Spirit to fill your life, or to fill it again, full to overflowing? Will you pray from now through the coming weeks to be filled? Will you pray now to over the next few weeks to be refilled? Will you pray and say, God, I'm open and I'm hungry and I want everything that you have for me. Fill me with the power of your Holy Spirit. Will you begin the exciting adventure of allowing Christ to fully reign in your heart. Many great men and women of God have realized that they needed more strength than they could muster on their own. They realized that they couldn't do it alone. They needed more. Listen, there is no way that we can minister in our own strength. There's no way that we can live victoriously in our own strength. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to be made fresh and anew in our hearts and in our lives. Oh Lord, may our hearts yearn for you again today. May 2022 be a year that we as a church are led by His Spirit. Led by His Spirit today. My question for you is, will you ask? Will you make it an ask every single day? Father, fill me with your Spirit. Father, lead me with your Spirit. Lead me and guide me today. I want you to know, I want you to hear my heart this morning. This moment, when we come to the end of a service, many times we have an altar moment, whether that's prayer or we've had altar calls in the past where we're walking through and navigating all of those things. And as we do that in the day and age that we live, I want you to know that our God still wants to move on His children. He has good gifts for us. And I want you to know, in this service today, this altar does not begin and end on this Sunday. This altar moment begins today, and it walks with us all through this week, all through the next week, all through our fasting and prayer. What I am going to ask you to do today is to maybe consider what you will lay down. Consider this week what you will fast. Consider and ask the Lord what He might do in your heart and in your life. Would you with me this week prepare, seek the Lord, ask Him, God, what do you want to do in my life? Lord, I want you, and God, I want to be filled with your Spirit. So this week, I'm going to prepare, because the next week, we're going to launch into a time of fasting and prayer, because I believe that God wants to move mountains in our lives. And in this moment, spiritually, Jesus asked His followers to fast. In fact, when He did that, he taught them how to fast. He did it Himself. Through fasting and prayer, victory is had. If you need victory in your life, I encourage you this week to seek the Lord and say, God, what would you have me give? I will lay it down, because I want to lay down the temporal for the eternal. I want what you have, because how many of you know He has way better stuff than we can put or get or have. So we're going to lay it down, Lord, and we're going to seek your face, because Lord, we are hungry for more of you. So today we're going to lay down our desires for more of you. Will you ask Him? Will you spend this week preparing? Prepare your heart, prepare your soul for what He wants to do. This altar call does not close in this moment. This is the beginning of a week-long altar call where we begin to ask Him, God, what do you want to do? Do you need direction for your life? Do you need healing in your body? What are some of the things that you need breakthrough? Is there a sin in your life? You say, God, I want your victory, and so I'm going to fast and I am going to pray, because I need your victory in my home. I need your victory in my family. I don't know what it is. I know there's some things that I am going to be seeking the Lord for. I cannot wait to dive in and to grow closer to Him, because I want all that He has for me. Come on, will you join me and pray for that this week? Will you join me and ask God to do those things all across this room? Balcony, side to side, would you just stand to your feet right now? Worship team, would you come? We're going to close this service singing a song, a declaration We are going to invite and ask the Lord to set a fire deep in our soul that He would burn in our hearts and in our lives. And this is our moment to begin that process of asking the Lord, Lord, what do you have? What should I lay down? God, what do you have for me? I want all that you are in my life. I want to walk in the Spirit. I want to live by the Spirit, because if He said I need it, I need it. How many of you want it? How many of you need it? Come on, let's extend our hands to the heavens right now. Father, I pray over this moment as we sing this song. May our hearts turn on fire for you. May you burn in us. And God, would you do a great work in our hearts and in our lives. In Jesus' name, let's seek Him together right now. Jesus.
I want more of you, God. I want more.
God, would do. We want more of you, God. We thank you for the word of God that have come forth today, Lord. And God, our prayer today, Lord God, is that as we end today, God, is God, as we study the book of Acts, that we will see and experience the book of Acts. We don't want to just go through it, God. We want to experience it, God. We don't want to just read it. We want to experience it, Lord Jesus. God, we live in a world where we have been taught not to touch fire. And God, your word is just the opposite. It says draw close to the fire. And that when we get closer to that fire, or we get hotter, we get warmer, Father God, we ignite, Lord Jesus Christ. And so, God, I pray, God, that with each chapter, with each verse, that we would draw closer to fire, God. Ignite us, Lord Jesus Christ. Ignite us, God. And as Pastor Kurt said, God, help us, God, to live in and live out the promise of God. In Jesus' mighty name, everyone said amen. Come on. This is going to be an exciting series. I challenge you to come back next Sunday and bring somebody with you. Next Wednesday, we'll be here doing Bible study, studying the Word of God. Don't be here this Wednesday. We won't be here. But next thing, we'll be here. And this coming Sunday, next Sunday, we are excited to see you. Come ready to draw close to fire and to experience the book of Acts in your life. God bless you, Saginaw First.